I had an accent, but. All right, figurative language. Overall definition, like I said, I'll zoom in and out here. It's non-literal language or description. So simple examples, I shouldn't say simple, but examples that you're probably already familiar with, metaphor, simile, personification, kill the light switch, hyperbole. Those are some basic ones. We're going to go into a little bit more detail with some little bit more extensive ones here in a little bit. What is a metaphor?
Couldn't tell if you said does or does not. So comparison that doesn't use like or has. I don't know you folks very well, so I can't say anything with any accuracy. Tyler's a beast. I don't know if you are or not. Tyler's a beast. Metaphor. How could I make that into a simile? Tyler acts like a beast. Who has lunch next period? Austin eats like a ravenous. You say pig?
No.
Okay. So you're making a comparison with simile that's using like or as. Personification, it's still a type of metaphor. You're given human-like qualities. You don't have to be writing these definitions down. It's just us talking so far as what I'm saying here. I want you to write this down, but you don't have to be defining those terms. Personification, you're given human-like qualities to something that is not a human. Kill the light switch. You don't actually kill the light switch. Hyperbole. Don't know that one. Had the shoulder shrug.
Wait, what is it again?
Hyperbole.
Isn't it like...
No. Some of you used this after yesterday.
Like,
Zach?
It's a point of emphasis. You exaggerate to emphasize.
I was trying to get there.
So,
like the hallway is 1,000 miles.
Yes. Yesterday, you know, if you were to go, you know, yesterday took 14 years to get through, you know, because of the first day back to school, that would be a hyperbole. Yesterday felt like 14 years, or the hallway seemed like 1,000 miles. Now you're going into simile because you're using
like or
as. So, one of the things to understand, and here's why I think some people, hopefully not all by any means, why some people get stuck on their quiz next week, it's a two-page quiz, one sheet of paper front and back. Front side, you folks will be perfectly fine on, I hope, because it's matching. Terms, definitions. What do you have to do on the back? Recognize examples. So you would have to realize that if it says the hallway seems like 1,000 miles, that you would put that down as a sentence. If it says that, you know, Austin is a beast, that would be a metaphor.
What's the reason for figurative language for the most part? Couple things. It's used for comparison, emphasis, clarity. Could be freshness where it makes something just a little bit different. I'll raise this up so you can see it better. Overall, it enhances writing. Quickly gets an image or a point across. How was yesterday?
Day took 14 years. I know within a quick sentence that was a long, brutal day. If you were to go, it was a long day, and here's all the details about it, it might not be as efficient. It might not speak quite as well to somebody about how that day was going.
It's important for us, not because, I mean, not solely because I want to enhance your writing, I do. A lot of the text that we're going to look at, there's a lot of different types of figurative language. You know, within the next couple weeks, we're going to be looking at those examples to see if you can recognize and what does it help to do. Because it's certainly something that a lot of writers go back to.
Is this in your writing? Keith, is this in your writing?
No, it's not.
I figured by your eye level and distance that we were good. I've given you a headache within like the first 10 minutes?
Yeah, my teeth.
Braces.
I just have my... Shut up.
wisdom teeth?
I saw my wisdom teeth last week and they still hurt.
Okay. Yes, you can. Remember, hall passes back behind Zach. Make sure you sign out on the log sheet. Okay. And then, Max, you will want to get the notes in off somebody, you know, for the couple that you did miss. Or spend quality time with me if you want. All right, first one. Tyler, you know how to say this? That's what I was hoping you would not say. Antithesis. Antithesis is like the opposite of what we want. So when you do your first essay, I don't want you to write an antithesis statement. I want a thesis statement. Call antithesis. 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 Katie, I know you're not using it, but you won't put your cell phone away, please. Thank you. So here's what antithesis is. It's an opposition. It's a contrast. It's a difference between ideas that are expressed in parallel form, which we'll get into that, or they're pretty much opposites that are strongly contrasting one another. So an example, besides what's up here on the board, over the summer, in beginning of August, there was a big 50-year celebration. Anyone know for what in the science field? 50 years ago, moon landing, 1969. Who was the first person to walk on the moon? Neil Armstrong. You know what he said? You know what the famous quote is of his when he gets on the moon?
I give up.
You started it.
I don't remember the rest.
One small step for man, one giant leap for mankind, okay? That would be an example of antithesis, because what you're doing is you have two sentences that are in parallel form. One small step for man, one giant leap for mankind. The sentences have a similar structure. They're parallel, like lines in geometry. What's the contrast? For a man, it's a small step. But for mankind, what is it? Giant leap. How can something be a small step for one person and a giant leap for the other? Unless you're talking about a person who's 2'4" versus someone who's 8'8". So one small step for man, yet it was one giant leap for mankind. It would be an example of antithesis. The opening lines, and not that you need to have read this book, but the opening lines of A Tale of Two Cities, it was the best of times, it was the worst of times. What's the contrast? One sentence, it's best. The next sentence, worst. How are they parallel? Because they start the same way. It was the best, it was the worst. And then you have of times on the end. All right? It was the best of times, it was the worst of times. Here's what you want for your notes. You definitely want to have the term, antithesis. You definitely want to have the definition. The example, I leave that up to you. I told you that for the quiz, you need to know examples to be able to recognize them. If you want to write that example down, you can. If you want to write down moon landing, small step, giant leap, you can do that. Whatever's going to help you the best. If you came in here already knowing antithesis, well done. You might not have to write down that example. So whatever is going to help you. But do note that when we do your notebook check, you know, we're looking at your figurative language. I'm looking to make sure this is here. I'm going to look to make sure the next term is there and whatnot. So you have contrasting ideas being brought together, create some kind of emotional appeal. It can be a point of emphasis, but it helps to get an idea across to the audience. So contrast can be used to examine pros and cons of a subject. It can push the audience towards a specific judgment of the subject as well. The main thing is going to be this first one up here. Contrasting ideas are brought together to create some kind of emotional appeal.
You missed chemistry. That class is rough. That class is useful. It's antithesis. It's a contrast. It's rough, but there's something that could be useful out of it.
Some of you might be an antithesis. I'm a slob.
But I'm organized.
Anyone think of any other examples off the top of your head? Keith, totally separate question. Do you remember how many bells are going to ring before you get up? So you get up on the fourth. Good job. So contrasting ideas brought together helps to create an emotional appeal. We're going to go back to like elementary school dances. What was the first antithesis example?
You're the light, you're the night.
Okay. So, well, where are we at? There we go. So you take a look, and I'm not going to go through the whole thing, gets into some other ones. You're the light, you're the night. There's a contrast there. Light, what do you associate with night? Darkness. Still written in parallel form. You're the cure, you're the pain. Opposites, something that is causing some kind of strife, pain, uncomfort, something that's going to fix it. How can that one person be both? Those would be examples of antithesis. All right. So if that's something writing down that you want to put to help you out, that would be perfectly fine. All right, next one's illusion. This is one that gets used a ton. This is one that we're always going to be talking about. Illusion is a reference to a well-known person, place, event, could be literary work, could be an art. It says indirect up here. It doesn't have to be indirect. It could be direct. But you are referencing someone or something. I made an illusion about 5 minutes ago when I was talking about earlier this summer. What did I allude to? Landing on the moon. All right, that was an event from 50 years ago. I referenced it. That would be an illusion. If I were to start off class going 4 score and 7 years ago, our forefathers set forth a new nation. Who am I quoting? Not George Washington. Nope. Abraham Lincoln. Okay? That's an indirect allusion because I didn't go according to Abraham Lincoln. Constitution, George Washington, right ballpark, but it was an indirect allusion, so I didn't know it quite as much. If I were to go, hey, life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, Declaration of Independence, all right? So you allude, you reference something. You know, how was your first day of school? World War II all over again. You made an allusion. Must have been horrific, must not have been very good. Once we finish this one. So don't act like a Romeo in front of her. You know, don't act like you're trying to impress her, that you're trying to be boyfriend or anything along those lines. So you make a reference to it right away. For an allusion to work, it has to be well known. So if there's an inside joke taking place about something that happened at lunch last week and you make reference to it, it's technically not an allusion if it's not well known by most people. The point of it is you use it to tap into the emotions that you associate with something well known by that audience. Anyone terrible at drawing? Like really bad?
Yes.
Okay.
I literally draw a fish.
Aaliyah draws something, we walk by and go, well, that's not a Mona Lisa, because you know that's a well known piece of artwork.
Like you can't draw stick figures?
One day, when the glory comes, it will be out, it will be out. Oh, one is one, we will be sure. We will...
What, I'm going to keep going. What's being alluded to? Discrimination? Civil rights movement? How do you know?
I don't mean to be a stupid question.
Probably more, it could be the song, if you're already familiar with it. It's probably not the words yet, if you're watching it for the first time, because you haven't gotten into the specifics. It could be the image. So it is certainly alluding to civil rights movement. You know, you could even say 1950s, 1960s, because you can tell it's not, you know, modern. So it doesn't have to always necessarily be words. I could put up a bunch of pictures, and you could know what I'm referencing, what I'm alluding to. Most of the time, it will be words, but it certainly could be other ways that you go about it. So images could be one way. Certainly the words can end up being another way as well.
Hands to the heavens, no man, no weapon. Formed against, yes, glory is destined. Everyday women and men become legends. Sins that go against our skin become blessings. The movement is a rhythm to us. Freedom is like religion to us. Justice is juxtaposition in us. Justice for all, just ain't specific enough. What this is us, that's why Rosa sat on the bus. That's why we walked through Ferguson with our hands up.
Okay, so now we're getting a whole host of different things that we could identify as being specific allusions that are taking place. First one, right off the bat, even though I didn't highlight it, heavens. What do you associate with heavens, especially if it's capitalized?
A place of peace and tranquility.
Okay, peace, tranquility, religion, you know, something that's a little bit more sacred, something that is supposed to be good. When you start coming in here to justice, why would we say justice for all? What do you start to think of with justice for all? Pledge of Allegiance, Constitution, Declaration. It's in of Independence. It's indirect, but you're referencing it. Now, specific ones. What are two real specific ones that I have right down here? Rosa sat on the bus. You say, if you hear the name Rosa, number one, a lot of people start thinking about Rosa Parks. Number two, you put the bus turn next to it. You've now cemented that you're associated with Rosa Parks, Birmingham bus boycott. Next to it, more recent, Ferguson. We're talking about Ferguson, Missouri, much more recent within our lifetimes. Okay? Didn't quite get to it so far as playing the track for it, but down at the bottom, we have King pointed to the mountaintop. What are we talking about when we go there? Martin Luther King Jr. So there are specific references now that are taking place. So allusion could be something that's going to be direct. It could be something that's a little bit more indirect with it. All right. Imagery. I think this one we're a little bit more familiar with. Use of description. Figurative language to represent objects, actions, ideas that appeal to our physical senses. 99% of the time, I think when we talk about imagery, people associate it with sight. But it could be any of the five senses. So it could be sight, smell, taste, touch, oh, I'm forgetting, sound, what you hear. But usually you tend to think of it as more of a visual thing.
What is the screen?
Yeah, try it. I don't know how well it's going to work. So, example, Romeo and Juliet, she doth teach the torches to burn bright, seems she hangs upon the cheek of night like a rich jewel in an Ethiop's ear. Burn bright, torches are certainly going to be the main example of imagery that's taking place. You do sometimes with imagery kind of have some cross stuff taking place with imagery and like similes or metaphors or whatnot, but you're appealing to a sense. Sight, smell, taste, touch, hear. Yeah, I can bring this one up.
And just a reminder, it's on Google Classroom as well. So, say you're not here tomorrow, unfortunately, you'd be able to pull up the rest of it that way too.
You know what would be more sad than that? If I weren't here tomorrow.
Yeah, I know. I'll be here tomorrow. Boy, I hope so. The last time, though, I said something like that, I had the appendectomy done. Wasn't planning it. Like, don't worry, no matter what, I'll be here tomorrow, and then I'll be here. Austin, I think they might have been sad. Just a little bit.
Something like, yeah, two or... So what it ultimately does, slide this down here for you, it aids the reader's imagination to clearly envision, to see characters, scenes in the literary piece. It's helping to evoke some emotion as well. So it's something that you use to kind of tap into reader's emotion, or listener if it's something that you're speaking. Don't I look like a Swiftie? Told you, we're going back to elementary school. So, James Dean, which would be also a what? A person. So it's an allusion. You're making a reference to somebody. Daydream, look in your eye. Red lip, didn't get to it. Long hair, slick back, white t-shirt. Those would all be images that you're taking a look at. So that's where that imagery would be occurring. Anaphora. This might be a new one. Anaphora, you also hear the term anaphora that gets used. It's repetition. So it's repetition of the same word or group of words at the beginning of multiple sentences or clauses. So if I were to go into speechifying mode, I might go, every day we work to the bell. Every day we keep our notebook out until lesson is done. Every day, we make sure that we're putting in a full 40 minutes. I am using anaphora by going every day at the beginning of those sentences. It occurs more with speech than it does, I would say, with writing. Because if you're speaking to someone, they don't have the text in front of them. How do you emphasize the point? You keep saying it over and over again.
But like music, with that music.
Sure, yeah, music, well, and it could be any genre of music.
Yeah, definitely.
The music will do it all the time. You see a picture of Martin Luther King?
Yeah.
What's his most famous speech?
I have.
What phrase does he use? I have. And there's a lot more than just that one that he uses. At the beginning, when he's talking about all the injustices that have occurred, he goes, now is the time for these things to change. Now is when we are no longer going to wait. Now is when change must occur. So there's that emphasis of now that keeps going over and over.
What are these coupons?
I'm good, thank you.
Okay, they were just in my notebook.
I appreciate the offer.
Like schools up front.
So repetition could be same word, could be group of words at the beginning, but it's multiple sentences over and over and over again. And this is the final one that we're taking a look at. So once you have that definition down, if you want to write I have a dream MLK speech, that would be certainly fine.
Does the same also apply if it's the same?
At the end of the sentence? That's not going to be one of the words that we do. Technically, that's a different thing. That's called epistrophe. So everyone knows things are up to date.
Yeah.
Good to hear. I'm glad you don't have to hopefully worry about it.
Yeah, I don't